Today on the Drum Hustle podcast, we have Scott Houston, drummer for the legendary Kincaid Band. Scott has been with the Kincaid Band about 6 years now and is a local drummer, vocalist, and songwriter. And Scott's theme is never stop learning. So let's just dive right in.
How are you?
Doing good, man.
Awesome.
Thanks for coming down, man.
Thanks for having me. I love it. This is great. I'm excited.
Hey, let's jump right in. So tell me about how you got hooked up with the legendary Kincaid Band, as you say, the Rolling Stones of Knoxville.
That's what I call them. Yes, sir. Interesting story. I was in a band, and the band just broke up one night. That was it. And no warning, no nothing, just broke up, you know. And I was just out at a gig somewhere, just walking around. I was at a private party, birthday party. And Bill Kincaid was there, and I said, hey, man, you know, I met you a couple of years back. I was with another group at the time, and I said, if you ever need a drummer, give me a call. You know, here's my number. Literally 6 months went by, and he called me. He finally called me, and I went to audition for them, and I think it's still a funny story. I went to audition with them, and I swore up and down that Mr. Dangerous Dave, our bass player, just didn't say anything to me at all the night that I was auditioning with them. Not a word. And I went back home and I said, I don't think the bass player liked me at all. I don't think I'm going to get this gig. Turns out he said to Bill, hire him. I want that gig. I want that guy in the band. Hire that guy. And next month will be my 6 year anniversary with them.
Wow. It doesn't seem that long, man.
It doesn't. It flew by real fast. We all get along real well. You know, we're like every other band. We're like a family where, you know, you're going to have this, that, and the other. But it just works for us.
They've been a band, I know Bill and Tron have, since the 70s.
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken.
Bill and Tron hooked up in the 80s, right. Dave and Bill have been working together since the 70s. Tron came off the road and they were playing and they said, you know, they had Tron sit in. And since then, he's been the lead singer for the band, and he's going to be 74 years old this year in December. And he's just still belting
out AC/DC just like anybody else. It's crazy. And he has the coolest name in Knoxville.
He does.
No, he really does.
He does.
He does, man.
Yeah.
And you guys record some too, don't you?
Yeah.
Every now and then.
We have a bunch of original songs, Spotify. We have our own radio station on Pandora.
Yeah.
Louder FM, Google Play, Amazon, everything.
I'll put that in the notes as well. Mm-hmm. and links to all that.
Yeah, we're everywhere on there. Yeah, they've got a bunch of original songs on there, and I have some on there as well with them.
Yeah, and those guys are solid too, man. I mean, if you've been with them that, you know, six, doesn't seem like 6 years. Where does time go, man?
I don't know anymore. It just flies right by.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you, where did you, when you were a kid, when did you start playing the drum? What's kind of your backstory, your history? Did you just wake up one morning and with a snare drum?
No. My older brother was in a high school marching band in Hollywood, Florida.
Oh, okay.
And I would just see him come home with these thick, big things, drumsticks. You know, I didn't know. I just looked like mini baseball bats. They were so thick. And I wasn't sure. I was like, what is going on? And I would just see him banging away on drums. And next thing you know, I start pounding on my mom's bar stools. She got a bar and new bar stools, and I just started going to town on it and put a big old rip in the middle of it. And
with marching drumsticks.
Mom got mad.
Yeah, but they're like small tree trunks.
Yeah. Mom got mad and said, you need to get this boy a drum set. She was a singer as well.
Right.
And my stepmom, she was a singer as well, and I played drums for her as later on down the road. So I just got a drum set, listened to all the stuff off the radio, and just started banging. My first time behind a drum set, I couldn't reach the kick pedal, and I couldn't reach the hi-hat. So I just banged away. That was it.
Yeah, it's like, man, just push the clutch on the hi-hat down. Hey, that solves that problem.
Yeah. When I was able to reach it, I finally knew what was going on.
Yeah.
And the band that I would jam with, they just played the same song over and over and over and over again until I got it right. And then they would give me another song. And I was like 12 years old at the time.
Wow. And I think we grew up in about the same era. So some of your influences, were you more of a rock guy back then?
I was. Bad Company.
Yeah.
You know, 38 Special, Kansas, Toto, all those guys. I was listening to
Jeff
all that.
Jeff Porcaro, man.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
He's on my wall up there when he was with Steely Dan. Well, when he recorded with him.
But, wow.
Yeah, man. Jeff, he's, yeah, something. Yeah. But, you know, well, so... When did you start your first band? Were you in high school, middle school, when you got into your first? Because I was, like, in high school before I started.
I started my first band. I was in middle school in Florida.
Yeah.
And started with a band. And then my mom brought me to this guy when I was about 17 years old. A guy named Chopper. He had a band back in Florida called Chopper and the Lone Star Band. And they were... They had an album. They did a live album at Club Dallas in Fort Lauderdale. And my mom's like, told my father, he's ready to do something. He needs to go get a life experience. So at 17 years old, before my 18th birthday, I was on the road with this guy and heading to Anchorage, Alaska for 2 months.
Before your what birthday?
I turned 18 in Anchorage, Alaska.
Wow.
I literally turned 18 years old in Anchorage.
On the road.
We went to Alaska for 2 months, and I played at a place called the Buckaroo Club on Spinard Road in Anchorage, Alaska. And we played 6 nights a week there. I mean, it was a 6-night gig.
Oh, yeah.
It was crazy. So that's
plus, what year was that? Because things were a lot different back then. I mean, I don't want to date you, but I know.
No, it's okay. You can.
If it hasn't been in the last 20 years, things were different 20 years ago.
Yeah. I mean, you know? I'm going to be 49 this year in November. So I was just, yeah. It's been a minute.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Where in this town can you get a 6-night gig, you know? It's not, I mean.
Not anymore.
Back when I used to, you know, in the early 90s, you know, you were lucky to get Thursday, Friday, and Saturday,
mm-hmm.
You know, and it was tough on a work night, you know, so you come from a musical family, you said your mom?
Well, my stepmom was a singer, but my grandparents, my grandma played the piano, and my grandfather played the harmonica, and I am also, not a lot of people know the name, but there was a famous country singer named David Houston back in the day. Did an album with Tammy Wynette, Loretta Lynn, all Patsy Cline, and my father is his second cousin, so I'm related to a somehow second cousin, and I met the guy before he passed, and told him who I was, and he kind of just blew me off, and I was like, alrighty then.
Welcome to the music scene.
Yeah. So yeah, so much for having a famous cousin.
Yeah. Yeah, typical music scene stuff right there, man. So after Alaska, what? I know you didn't just come straight to Knoxville after that, apparently.
No, because I was still living in Florida there at the time. After Alaska, came back, still played with the Lone Star Band, but unfortunately, he's still with us, thank God, but he got into a motorcycle wreck, and... Yeah. And so the band had to disband because he didn't know when he was coming back. And so there I just started bouncing back and forth for other local bands in Florida. And then ran into another band, went back out on the road back in 2000, and headed back out there and did a whole big tour out in Nevada and everything. We played Vegas, played Mesquite, Nevada, Elko, Nevada. We went all over the place.
So what brought you to Knoxville, Scotty?
Well, my ex-wife's job brought us here.
Money.
Yeah, my ex-wife's job brought us here. And I actually did not, at the time, I was not sure if I wanted to stay or not.
Right.
And we were not married at the time. So I was like, now I was going to go back to Florida. But, you know, I stuck around. And at the time, I did not even know there were any bands around. People were like, hey, if you want to go and sing and music or whatnot, there's a karaoke bar in Knoxville. Go check that out.
Yeah.
And did that. Luckily, a few local musicians just wandered in, you know, and got up and sang. And I was like, man, they're really good. And found out that they were actual players in town. And they just started hooking me up and saying, networking, hey, here's some number. That's it. They started networking. I networked with them. I went from band to band to band to band around here.
Yeah.
Kincaid's literally the longest band I've been in since I've got a 6-year anniversary coming up with them in April.
Absolutely, man. That's great. That's great. And that was pre-social media, too, when you were doing that stuff. Or, you know,
MySpace was still a thing back then.
Yeah. I think I still have an account somewhere.
Maybe I might.
Maybe I'll log in. All right. Let's get into some roadblocks you've had to overcome. You know, you've been sick a little bit and injuries, things like that. You know, something we might could all learn from is how you pressed on, went through that, you know, what it was and found the right sub. What was your thought process, you know, when you knew that you had to take some time off, and how'd that come about?
Well, I was actually stubborn for a while when I was sick, you know, and I just had this infection inside me and was just messing with me. So I kept going and going and going on and on and revamping my drums, you know, triggering things up and trying to be able to go and play and having Bill Kincaid or anybody tune down a whole step for me to try to sing everything. I just kept going. After a while, my body just couldn't take it anymore. This year in July, it'll be 3 years since I had my surgery and everything.
Right.
So it's only been 3 coming up, which is crazy. But
almost half your Kincaid career.
Yeah. The guys stuck with me. They helped me load in the equipment, load up my drums, put them back in, help me set them up to where they were like, Scott, don't do anything. Just play when we're ready to play. And 5 minutes before show, I'd bandaged up and get back on stage and start wailing at it for as long as I could. And then after a while, I set up the surgery. It had to be done or I was going to be done, basically.
Yeah.
And so our mutual brother in drummer in arms, whatever you want to call him, Mr. Bobby Brown, stepped in.
BB.
That's right, the Rock BB man. BB. That's right.
Yes,
he stepped in and played for Kincaid for as long as he could. And then as I was recovering, Bill's like, you know, BB's got to go back to where he was with his other band. Can you come back? So my girlfriend, thank God for her, she set up my little rolling drum pad in the corner of our living room, and I'd get up and try to play, and I just didn't cut it the first time in. Go back and lay down, wake up, and it's dark outside, you know, because I would sleep for 9, 10, 11 hours and didn't realize it. I was just wiped out.
Yeah. Was this before your surgery or after your surgery?
This is during the recovery process.
Okay, during the recovery of your surgery, gotcha.
Because after my first surgery, 5 days later, I had to have another one because something went wrong. So then...
Oh, I didn't know about the second
one. Yeah, there was a second one, unfortunately, and stuck in ICU for quite a bit. And so, but eventually, I got stronger and stronger and came back. And singing was a little rough first time out because it felt like I was choking, you know, because I just couldn't get anything out.
You know, that's the thing. And I was going to get into a little bit about drummers that do other instruments. And singing obviously is. But, you know, we have it physically tough as it is, you know, doing cover gigs like we do when you play 3 and 4 hours a set. But when you put singing on top of it, you're physically wore out, you're mentally wore out, your lungs are wore out in your case, and you know. So yeah, that's some good stuff, man. And I'm glad everything turned out for the best. And you know, Knoxville, I'm thankful that there's a lot of great people around like BB, you know what I mean? Just to come in and not try to take your gig. You know, I've heard so many stories.
Yeah.
You know,
I was worried in the beginning that, oh man, I'm not going to be able to get back.
Yeah, they're going to like this cat.
But then I get on Facebook, and then the band would post where they were going to be at, and BB's picture's on there, and then boom, I'm right there too. So I was always in the Facebook post when they would go out and play.
Yeah.
So I was like, and I would look at my picture and go, all right, I'm good, you know, and... Bill and I became such best friends, and he's just such a genuinely nice guy. And on top of being a heck of a guitar player, he's just a great guy to be talking with.
Yeah.
And, man, he kept my spot. You know, he knew. He's like, no, Scott's coming back. And then when I did come back, we got a lot of new fans while I was gone, and they didn't even know that I was the original guy.
They're like,
hey, what happened to Bobby? Who's this guy?
Yeah, it was the community taking care of you. The music community around here. That's why I like to tell a lot of people that we're fortunate to be near Nashville, but we're, you know, it's okay that we're not right on top of it, because there's so many people that just go to Nashville and try to make it, and they'll throw bands together. If that would have happened to you in Los Angeles, New York, or Nashville, or Miami, you know, you may not have had a home to go back to.
No,
you know,
not at all.
You know,
it's a little cutthroat, more or less, more in those areas, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, especially. So do you still do the hired gun thing now that you've recovered and recuperated and all that stuff?
Every now and then, if Kincaid has a break or anything, I'll do acoustic shows with a buddy of mine, Drew Robbins. That's the Mellow Yellow thing.
Yeah.
And I haven't done a hired gun thing in a while because I've been pretty busy and fortunate enough to, between Kincaid and then Kincaid Trace, our little trio that we have. And then the Mellow Yellow thing. With all that going on, there's no time to be a hired gun anymore.
Right.
Which I like because...
Yeah.
I love it. I just love being... I like doing what I'm doing right now.
Yeah. And when you do the hired gun thing, what's some advice that you like... how do you learn songs for the hired gun thing? And let me rephrase it. There is a few songs everybody knows that everybody in Knoxville plays, you know. So it's like, okay, we know this. But sometimes you may get a set list up front if you say, hey, I'm going to go play with, I have to play with XYZ tomorrow at Bracken's. I don't know. I'm just throwing that out mm-hmm. there. And it's like, okay, I'm not really familiar with this genre. I know these cats. Do you wing it or do you like make notes? Chart stuff out, or does it depend on what they're telling you?
They will send a set list and stuff, and a lot of times a lot of the songs are the same,
but you get that 7 or 8, man.
It's like, oh, and then there's that, and that's when I put on the wings and start winging it, because
you
know,
at least listen to it.
I will listen to it a little bit, and I'm like, okay, I see what's going on here. Kincaid got me real tricky about that when they first started sending me a bunch of songs in the beginning. I went, oh my goodness, what is this?
Yeah.
Dancing Days and Ozzy and Elvis and this and everything else.
Yeah.
But I like to just, I like to wing it. I like to just feel the music.
Right.
With the other musicians, whether I know them or if I don't know them. Sometimes it's better to wing it when you don't know them, because they can feel that, hey, this guy's up here and he's feeling the music. I can dig this, what this guy's doing. I like this.
Exactly. Your electronics, your toilet bowl, the legendary toilet bowl. Let's go into that for a few minutes, because I've always wondered, I know what it is, but I don't know what it is. I mean, I've got one of these, but I don't know the difference between that and what you
the
have.
The one that I have or had, it's actually being repaired right now. It's been through the lot with me. I put her through the ringer.
And you've had it for a long time.
I have had it for a long time, and it just finally died on me and just went kaputs. But it's being repaired, and hopefully it'll come back for the second coming of the toilet bowl or toilet thing. It is a Roland Hand Sonic 15.
Okay.
Gotcha. And it you can play with your hands. I prefer drumsticks, and I can attach a kick tower, electronic kick tower to it with that, and get that conga, that Cajun, you know, cajon beat thing going on. And it's just so convenient, and it doesn't take up a lot of space. And I also like to use it when it's with me in the live band situation, sound effects, because it's got Viber Slap on there,
right?
In the little eye area, just put my stick over the area, and it just makes the rattling Viber Slap
and no bleed. Everything, it sounds the same
exactly
every night.
Exactly.
So you're cool with electronics.
I really am. I didn't like having to use them in the beginning when I was sick, but now that I'm doing just fine, I like going back and forth from acoustic to the electronics, but there's just nothing like a live
absolutely
set.
but you know, there's nothing. I totally agree, man. The acoustic kit is where it's at. But if you're not going to, I'm not going to haul that in for $50. You know what I mean?
They're lucky they'll get a kick and a snare.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If it's $50, it's a one trip, and it better be fun too.
Exactly.
But I'm just kidding about the $50. But but that is cool that you can put that with your live kit too. And because I remember, I'm sure I got to see you once way before the Kincaid band. I think it was you, Michael Paul, MVP. You, Michael Paul, and...
it was Michael Essex.
Plan 9. Plan 9, yes. Yep. You were playing at the old, the new Fins. It was called Baker Peters Club back then.
Yep, we were
and
there.
And I was like, what's this cat? That was before I really knew him. I was just getting back in the music. I was like, what's that cat playing up there? What is that, man? And it sounded great, you know. Of course, that's an odd room anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But I've played in that room, and I've loaded drums up those back stairs. It's like three stories of stairs. I'm like, this guy is smart. This guy, he has less to bring in than the singer does. You know,
yep.
When they say last call, he's the first one done.
That's right. That was the idea.
Yeah, that was a, when I saw that, I had to ask about that.
Work man. Smart, not hard.
Yeah. Yeah. And the sounds are really good too, man.
Yeah, they are.
All right. So how do you, since you play quite a bit now, you have a day job as well, right?
No, this is it.
So this is it. You're one of the few drummers. There's some singer-songwriters that get to do it, but you're one of the few drummers that get to do that. That being said, how do you juggle your family life? I mean, maybe you have more time since you don't have a day job, you know, but your hours are odd.
Yeah.
All musicians' hours are odd. You know, it's not a 9-to-5, obviously.
No, it's not. For me, and obviously everybody that knows me knows Momo.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's my boy, and being autistic, nonverbal, takes a little bit that extra mile to put in more to something like that.
Right.
I have the opportunity with what I do for a living to be able to spend more time with him when he's off from school, summer break, fall, winter break, all the stuff. You know, and I get to go and pick him up and spend the day with him. You know, I had him today. And it's just a great feeling that any time that he needs, that his mom needs me to be there for him, I can do it as long as I can get to my gigs. Now, there's some times that I have him and I got to rush off to the next show, like drop him off and go.
Right, right.
You know, and that has happened. But on the way up there, it was totally worth it. So I do love that I can do this and put all that time in and be with him when I need to be with him. It's great.
Yeah, and you have a supportive family, girlfriend?
My girlfriend, yeah, Pam, she supports me in this. And there's been a lot of,
you know, a special person to support a musician.
Yeah. And she has great love for my little boy as well, and he loves her. Yeah, and
it wouldn't
work.
Yeah, it wouldn't work.
It's not easy. Not only is it not easy just to be, you know, to be a part of somebody else's child, but now imagine an autistic child that doesn't talk, and their bond is like tight. These two just crack me up. They're tighter than anything. It's amazing how they get along and how they just crack each other up, and it puts a big old bump in the heart there, and I love every minute of it.
Yeah. You know, Knoxville, we're not Nashville, but we're really close. That being said, if you could go back in time a little bit, several years, what would you tell yourself? What kind of advice would you give yourself if you could see yourself, you know, talk to yourself back then right now? I mean, I've got a little story. No, I'm not going to go into it here. But I know what I would tell myself. But other than don't do it, no, I'm just kidding. Other than, hey, you know, get a master's degree. No, yeah. But seriously, what would you tell yourself back, you know, an advice? And this could even be applicable to somebody that's just graduated college at UT or just is interested in the instrument itself. Because we all know that Knoxville is a hard scene to crack into. But once you get into it and know the right people and network the correct way, you know, and not just try to be something you're not, you know, it works. But so what's your thoughts on that?
I would tell myself, never stop learning.
Right.
Just keep learning, because I figured, you know, if you stop learning your craft, whether if it's drumming or whatever you are doing, you know, then you might as well just stop. If you think you know it all, then you might as well just say, okay, you're done, you know, because nobody would want to ever work with somebody that doesn't have that mindset to want to continue to keep learning your craft. But as a drummer, I would definitely tell myself, you know, hey, by the way, you're going to be called the naughty one day down the road. The second thing is, don't ever stop learning. Always learn whatever you can. You know, go to somebody that's been playing a long time and learn from them. Don't
listen to their
advice. Give them the attitude. You know, now you may get a little hurt from somebody telling you, and honestly, it has happened to me in a drum competition not too long ago. And one of the guys kind of gave me that advice and said, do a drum solo that makes it sound like you're playing a song. Drag us into it. Don't just bang away.
And not only that, but you won that drum competition.
I did. I did, because I took that guy's advice, even though in the beginning he kind of ticked me off.
So you win a drumming competition and you're beating yourself down.
Yeah.
And didn't you score a set of drums from winning that? Man, that's great. That's good stuff. But you come out, you know what? The important part is you come out and you learn something from that.
I did.
It wasn't just, hey, I come out with some new drums that I get to use every night.
No, but I learned a lesson from that guy.
Absolutely.
I really did. It was one of those things like, oh, come on, this old guy, what is he talking about? La, 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 you know, whatever, you know, he's got a shirt that says Pearl on it, big deal. You know, who does this guy think he is, in a Panama Jack hat, you know, and a leather jacket? Yeah, I'm not going to listen to this guy. And then I went home and my girlfriend, she's like, you might want to be quiet and take the advice that you keep saying that you don't want to ever stop learning. I just never found myself in that spot where that would happen. And it did. And I sat back and said, you know what? I do tell myself that all the time. Don't ever stop learning. Went back, won the drums.
You did, and still use them.
I do.
Because I got to see you guys. I got to see you guys at up in Pigeon Forge, I believe it was, during the summer. Yeah, and those drums sound great too. How do you keep motivated playing a huge portion of the same songs every night? Because if you're like me, you know, most of us, some nights you don't have really a crowd. Some nights it's packed, depending on where you go, what the weather is. Is Tennessee playing football? You know, all that fun stuff.
Right.
How do you stay motivated during sets playing the same songs that you've played for years?
Well, I mean, I'm on the stage with not only guys that I'm in a band with, I'm up there with my friends.
Right.
I'm up there with my family. We'll have, just like everybody else, we'll have just kind of a dead night, like you said, and it's hard. But there's so much music and so many songs from A to Z that these guys do that they've done forever. We can switch up a night, whether we do the first three songs in the beginning of the night, and then we can change those first three songs and do something that we haven't done in a while. Bill will get really bored and just call out something we haven't played in over a year. And he's done that recently to us. And we're like, what? Dude, you haven't called this song in a while. Oh, I called it last week. No, you did not. I love you, Bill. and it's happened. But, and then there's times where Bill will noodle along in an intro of a song and just change things up on his guitar solo in the beginning of a song that makes you go, hey, what's he doing? And then I'll start building up, and then Dave will start building up on something. We improvise. And it's like, where's this coming from? This is awesome, you know?
Yeah. Submit and record this.
So there's a lot of times and that we can switch things up, whether it's the way we attack the song or whether it's the way we just, whatever he calls out for the song for the night. You know, we do anything from, what is it called? Turn on the lights, let your love shine on me, you know, stuff. Yeah. Blues Brothers, you know, Bobby Bluebell, whatever, you know. And then we'll go into Billy Squire, you know, or something else. So there's always something that's in the back of my mind thinking, okay, he's going to eventually change things up soon, so he knows we're not going to be bored for much longer. And he'll look at us and he'll go, okay, my guys are bored. I'm going to throw a curveball at him. And he does. And there's songs that he'll call out that we haven't played in so long that I love to do, or that I haven't had a chance to play on the live drums in a long time. And right. So there's stuff that I'm like, wow, last time I played this, I was sick and played on electronics. Now I'm doing it on a live kit. This is great. Let's do it. You right. know, Walk Away, James Gang or something. You know, I'm like, yeah, here we do it. You know,
yeah, it's been so. Plus, you know, it just hit me about, or it just hit me that I can imagine the catalog of songs that you guys have as long as the band's been together collectively. You know, even if you were just 6 years, you know, from its inception. But I can imagine the songs going around in Bill and Tron and those guys' head. You know,
they've had them in there forever. And
yeah, man.
They attack them different ways every night, you know. Or you know, Bill comes up with these great arrangements during a solo, and he'll get this thing that comes over him, and you can see it on his face, like oh, I'm gonna go. And Dave and I will look at each other and pretend we're looking at our watches, like, all right, here he goes. He's off and running. Mm-hmm. He's going to be there for a while. And it's okay, because let him loose. Do your thing. And he loves it. And he's having a great time. We're having a great time watching him having a great time. And that's what keeps me in this band as long as I've been in this band.
Right. You know, and I've seen, you know, you guys play before. And I've seen, you know when to back off. When somebody gets in the zone, you know how to just... Let somebody shine, you know. Let's just go to the hi-hat and side stick and just let him do his thing, man.
Yeah.
You know, step out of the way. You know, that's something that people can think about too, man. There's a lot of drummers that have one volume level and two beats.
Yeah. And exactly.
All night long. Mm-hmm. You know.
Oh, no, I know.
And, you know, I think you have something that's great too, which is listening, hear what's going on around you, not stepping on people's toes. So how do you feel about drummers learning more than one instrument? I mean, you know, having two. Because the reason I asked that is because I've picked up the upright bass a few years ago, and I'm still in like the middle school phase with that, you know what I mean? But
yeah.
I'm okay. That being said, I know you're a vocalist and you sing too.
Mm-hmm.
So that brings a lot to the table, you know, other than being a rock solid drummer, is, you know, that's kind of an instrument as well.
Right.
So I don't think it's necessary, but I want to get your thoughts on it being from a singer.
I was always told, you know, jack of all trades, a master of none. And I'm the guy that just, you know what, for over 40 years, I've been a drummer. I don't want to learn another instrument because my other instrument is that I am a singer. So I always say, if you're good at something, if you're talented enough and gifted enough to pick up another instrument and play it, go for it and do it. You know, I know rhythm guitar players that can play bass, you know, and they do it well, you know, and they're like, oh, I thought you were just a rhythm player. Oh, you play bass? Sure, great. But then you have just a guy that just plays bass or just plays drums, and we just go in and lock it in and do your thing, and that's that. And I love that about being just what I can do. And so that's where I am on that one, I would say. I'm just kind of, I'm a two-trick pony guy. I don't want to be any more than that. I sing, I play, I'm good.
And you've actually had recordings where you're the singer and... I mean, you have your own albums out, I believe, or CDs or Spotify.
Kincaid has a bunch of original songs out there. I'm
that
on there.
That you sing on.
I sing on a couple of them that I've written, but I wrote these before I joined Kincaid.
Oh, okay.
So it just kind of got meshed into what they're doing. My songs are not on Pandora with them because my songs did not meet the rock criteria, I guess. But
the genre didn't cross
didn't get it, and we're trying to fix that up now. But I'm still writing, I'm still doing stuff, you know, and I do perform the songs live occasionally as well. So I get
okay, so you bust out some live stuff.
We can do some live originals as well. Sometimes the feeling hits us, and we'll just say, hey, we haven't done this one in a while, and so we'll pop it out. And you know, one of my originals, Gone for Good, I've done a live performance on that a bunch of times whenever the feeling hits me to do it.
Right.
And I'd like to watch people's reactions, because now they're going, all right, there's a drummer, he's singing. Oh, wait, now he wrote this song? So that's kind of cool. I had one of my icons from back home in Florida when I was a young kid playing drums, and he would try to always distract me by, he would literally throw stuff at me, nothing heavy or anything like that. But he taught me a lot, you know,
right.
He would throw stuff at me. He's like, all right, just never get distracted. Don't ever show off when another drummer walks in the door, just play,
right.
You know, don't sit there and go, oh, hey, Scott Fugate's here. I'm going to like, yeah, all right. Hey, all right, here we go.
Yeah.
Gonna warm up and let's do this. Here we go. All right. We're going to get him. No.
Where's my double kick pedal?
Yeah. I don't have one. but no, my thing is like more like, hey, Scott's here. Cool. You know,
yeah.
Or Mighty Matt Tyler's in the house or whatever.
Yeah, man.
Cool. You know, I like it. BB's in the house. All right. Awesome. Great to see him. You know,
exactly.
That's kind of more what I...
That's maturing too, because I was guilty of that as a kid or younger, you know, not having the competition. It's not a competition, man.
No.
You know, I mean, if you're in Nashville at a cattle call trying to go on the, you know, get picked up on the road with I don't know, somebody that just won American Idol. It's like, you know, that's a competition. If you're in the drum line in high school, that's a competition. When you're out here, man, it's not a competition to me.
It's
at my age, you know.
No, it's definitely not a competition. But
yeah.
Unfortunately, there's some younger drummers out there that unfortunately like to think it is.
Yeah, absolutely.
And want to toss and twirl and just do cool tricks and balance things.
Balance.
I'm pretending to balance a drumstick in my palm. That's what I'm doing. And then they'll get off a stage and they're exhausted. They're tired. And they're like, oh, wow, I'm so exhausted. Yeah. I got an idea. You're not in the circus. You're on the drums. You're playing a song.
Wow,
quit showing off. Huh?
What an idea. Wow, what a thought, man. What about listening to the bass player, what they're doing, and trying to lock up with that, huh?
I've seen videos of drummers from just YouTube, whatever, and they're just all... and they're making all this racket and they're, hey, look at me, I'm twirling, I'm flipping, I can balance it on my nose and drink a Coca-Cola at the same time without spitting out water or whatever.
Yeah.
And then there's those guys like you and myself and our other friends in the drumming world, and
yeah,
we just want to sit down, we want to play. You get to let all that stress out
and play, and give the song justice, man, and the band, make the band feel good.
That's
yeah,
all you try to do, and not show off. But unfortunately, that's going to be a thing as drummers come up. They're going to want to, hey, look what I could do, you know.
But you know why? Because in my opinion, because if you go to Instagram, now I'm not okay. If you go to Instagram now and you see who's got a million followers and who has and who's getting Zildjian to sponsor you and send you all this stuff, it's these cats that are playing like that. Now, some of them can groove too. There's some people that God just said, let him groove, let him chop.
You saying all that and everything about, you know, us talking about the upcoming drummers, the younger guys and they're like that. I was fortunate enough to sit in a circle of drummers one time at that drum competition. We all met at the store, and then we went over to where the competition was happening. It was just like a circle of other just drummers, different ages were in the room. I was one of them. I was probably somewhere, but older or younger than somebody or something, you know.
Yeah.
And they just had a bunch of guys in the room, and they were just telling stories and sitting down, and you could learn something from them. And you know, I had mentioned, hey, quit showing off. You're not in a circus. You're trying to play drums. You're trying to play songs. And one of the younger cats kind of looked at me and just went, who the heck does this guy think he is? You know, what is he trying to say?
Yeah.
And
which that would have been me when I was 19, 18.
And as we moved, and as we moved to the competition, you know, he went up before me and did his performance, and he tried to tilt his snare drum for like, he was just trying to show off like jazzy type stuff.
Yeah.
You could barely hear him. Well, he didn't tighten the snare drum back up all the way to the stand. And as he was playing more, it kept tilting and tilting, and it ended up in his lap. So they said, hey, you want to take a break and, you know, come back or whatever. And then I went up and did my solo. And then the rule was, when the lights start flashing on the drums, your time is up.
Right. Wrap it up when the lights
flash. Well, they left them flashing from the last guy before me, and I thought my time was up, and you're disqualified if you keep playing when they start lighting up, flashing. But everybody was so involved in what I was doing. But anyway, after all that went down, the younger kid just came up to me, shook my hand, and we're friends now, you know, and he's like, man, you know, thanks for the advice. You know, I'm going to try to implement that into my playing from now on and stop trying to show off and do right. little tricks on my snare and loosen the snares and pop them back in and, you know, and
yeah,
and
turn it upside down.
Yeah, and put your hand behind your back or and go.
But on your nights off, I don't know, I may be wrong on this, but do you really want to go? I mean, unless it's a special occasion and you have a night off, do you want to go listen to music? I mean, you may. I don't know.
If it's a band that I don't get an opportunity to see a whole lot of and right. I like their style of music, I'll go and see them. It takes a lot for me to want to go and yeah, get out of the house.
I know it, man.
But a lot of times if it's somebody that I really like and I say, wow, I haven't seen them play in a long time. I need to go out there and check these boys yeah. out. It's been a while. Yeah. I'll go out and see them.
Well, that's great. That's...
You know, whether it's whoever it is, it doesn't matter if they're doing just like acoustic somewhere or if it's their full band. I will go out and see them if I feel like, yeah, I'm going to go check them out. I'll see them.
And that being said, us drummers don't get to network with each other like we should.
No, that's correct. We do not.
You know, and guitar players... I guess bass players might be in the same position we are, but guitar player, a lot of times you'll have multiple guitar players in a band.
Mm-hmm.
They'll know each other. And you have guitar players that can play bass and vice versa. Some of them can transition good, some can't, but they can pull it off. But they know each other, so the circle is a little tighter.
Mm-hmm.
But back to my point, when I was playing like 3 and 4 nights a week and having wedges of monitor mixes in my ears, that meant that long, it's like, wow, you know, let me stay home and watch Matlock, dude. You
know? I'm a Golden Girls myself, yeah. But it's all good.
Oh, man.
Well, that's why I use in-ears now. I've gone to those for singing and good. For playing.
And plus, you're going to enjoy it down the road because you can hear.
Yeah, I call it the bionic ear, so I hear literally everything going on in there now. Dave and I both use in-ears now. Love them. And now I don't have to lug around a big old heavy monitor and throw it on the floor and go, I can't hear anything. I can't hear anything. And now it's like, oh, I hear enough. I'm going to turn this thing down. Hang on one second. Exactly. Here we go. And then it helps me not have to sing as loud or try to put out so much. Guys go from anywhere... My influences would be Simon Kirk, Bad Company's drummer.
Oh, yeah.
Just a great drummer and a great singer, too.
Absolutely.
Of course, no shock here. Singing drummer call. Here we go.
Let's hear it.
Drop the bomb. Here it goes.
We know three.
I know. Well, yeah. Don Henley, Phil Collins.
Yeah.
And I can never remember the drummer's name from...
From that band. From the band? How about the drummer from the band?
The drummer from the band.
Live
Thank
on
you.
Helm.
That's my boy right there. And I don't even know the guy's name until
Live
somebody brings it up.
Yeah. He had so much soul.
Also the drummer from Grand Funk Railroad.
Yeah.
He's an amazing singer as well.
Yeah.
Phil Rudd.
No.
Chris Slade. Both AC/DC drummers right there.
Exactly.
And really, nobody really mentions him a whole lot, but I love Adrian Young from No Doubt. I think he's great. He's a great drummer, Chad Smith. That's my guy right there.
Yeah.
You know, can't stand Lars. Sorry, had to take a shot.
Yeah.
And Ringo Starr, of course.
Ringo, yep.
And Buddy Rich, Louis Belson, Cozy Powell. Well, I agree. Well, with Buddy Rich's band, I mean, you know, he had a big, big band behind him, and it was all because, God rest his soul, old Neil Peart there, you know, he did a tribute to Buddy Rich. And played with his band. It's all over YouTube, you know, yeah. and everything. And my father, oh, God rest his soul, what a great yeah. guy. And he brought me, it was on VH tape, The Superstars of Drumming. And I had all these amazing drummers. Cozy Powell was on there. The drummer for Deep Purple, Ian, was on there.
Really?
Sandy Nelson was on there. Somebody like
that. And that takes a lot because Steve Smith is up there with a Dave Weckles, Vinnie Code is...
Simon Phillips.
Yeah, man. You know, Thomas Lang. I mean, Steve Smith. Ugh. Him and Dave Weckl have a lot of similarities to me, you know, as far as... their chops, but they chop musically.
They do.
You know, especially even a solo. If you hear a Steve Smith drum solo, just him and a set of drums, it's so musical. It's not just, like Benny Greb says, falling down the stairs like on Charlie Brown, you know, or Snoop, or whatever those cartoons were. You know how those drum solos. Yeah, it's like, man, okay, that's awesome.
Well, I got a shout out to you real quick because I hadn't ever had a chance to tell you this, and whether we were being recorded or not, but if we're still being recorded, that's even better. The stuff that you do in the Steely Dan tribute band, dude, you are killing it. That's something that I see. That's not my style of playing. I could never switch over that. I can play the country stuff in my sleep and maybe slip into a coma. I don't know. I can classic rock all the time, no problem day long. But the stuff, the speed, the instrumentation, the arrangements, everything, that's not easy stuff to do. So props to you on that, thanks, my friend, Slam and Scott. That stuff is really amazing.
Yeah, it really is. The whole Steely Dan tribute thing, man. I really appreciate that. I do. It's the chemistry of everybody, and you talk, you know, we talked about, you know, kind of giving some advice to up and coming drummers. Mm-hmm. You talk about anxiety, sheet music for every
song. Oh my gosh,
I know it.
And I'm like, my goodness.
Okay, I can read pretty good.
Oh, see, I don't read music at all.
But here's the thing about it, it's like I cannot read that fast. I could maybe read half that fast when I was in middle school, you know. And I know what some of this stuff means, but I'm like, I had that fake smile on my face. Yeah, I got this. You know, I got this. Yeah.
Don't ever call me to have fill in for you for that, ever. Just say, just don't holler at me like, naughty. Oh, no, he told me not to call. I'm not going to call him. And then call me just to tick me off or something and make me go, dang it, Scott, no. You know, and then there's that other part of me playing for so long that I'm like, could I do something like that? And then there's the other part of me that goes, dude, forget about it. Just rock out every night.
Just put
like
the work
in,
man. That's...
And that's something I would do because it's a great challenge. Right. It goes back to, you know, never stop learning.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you know, all kidding aside, I would never stop learning, and it would be a really big challenge.
Yeah.
Even if I couldn't complete the task, if it was just so all over, at least I could say, you know what? I gave it a shot. I tried my best.
Come out of it learning something.
I learned something, and maybe I'll come back again and do it some other world down the road, you know.
And that's how I feel about the guy in Knoxville that was in the, remember when Rush had the Rush tribute with Walter Moore and those guys?
Yeah, like, Clockwork Angels.
It's like, man, I was like, from the outside looking in, it's like, this guy is playing those freaking notes. But I guarantee you this, pardon me, I guarantee you this, he didn't improvise it.
No, he did not.
I bet you he woodshedded that stuff because you don't improvise Rush.
I know Kenny.
Yeah, I don't know him that well.
Yeah,
but
I know the both brothers, Kenny and Mike Smith.
Yeah.
Mike was the guitar player for that band, his brother. No, they don't. He sat down. He put the woodshed on that bad boy. He just didn't walk up and go, hey, I can play like Neil.
Yeah.
Because there was one time that Neil didn't play like Neil until later on down the road.
Exactly. Advice alert.
Yeah, yeah. Big time advice alert. Yeah, so, yeah. Any of those type of tribute bands, you guys, the Clock, which I really wish that Clockwork Angels would have done a tour, a little show thing when Neil passed. They were a great tribute band. Because you're not it, and this is advice I'd give myself if I were talking to me now, and say, hey, listen to me, kid, still go and see bands, even if you're not into the type of music that, you know, that they play. you can still learn something from that band. You can learn what you guys do. You can learn what the Walter and those guys did. You can learn what the Journey. There's thousands of Journey and Kiss tribute bands now. They're way
in. And Led Zeppelin.
And yeah, they're called Greta Van Fleet. Anyway, moving along. Please don't edit that. No, don't edit that. We got to open up for a Kiss tribute band out of Kentucky.
Yeah.
Scratching my head. That's odd.
A Kiss tribute band from Kentucky.
And it was for New Year's Eve. And I was playing my little... I had my breakbeat drum set with me.
Oh, yeah, the small... Yeah.
And the drummer took up the entire stage, pretty much. And I had to sit right next to his drums because...
So he had the Peter Criss kit.
Minus the third kick drum. He had the both of them up there.
Oh, okay. Oh, he didn't have three. Then they weren't.
And by the way, he never touched them. Number one. Number two, he, and this is another thing I would give myself advice for. Real quick, I walked up to the guy. We're on before you guys. We're opening up. I introduced myself. Seemed like a great, nice guy. I'm like, okay, cool. Hey, man, I tell you what. I'll bring in my snare drum. I'll even set up my own cymbals. We'll save a lot of time, you know. No, not a lot of drummers will say, and I may not say that, you know, hey, yeah, go ahead. It's okay if you say, no, man, I'm not into that. But it's the way you say it.
It's the delivery.
It's the delivery.
I had that happen.
And the delivery was really rude. And I could just go, all right, fine. Walked out, grabbed my little drum set.
Nugget advice.
Yeah. Set it up next to his. His crash cymbals right here by me. I could have literally went bap like that.
While you're playing.
Right, but I did not. And me and poor Dave were way on the left side of the stage. Now, you could see us, but we felt disconnected from our band, from
right.
Cat, Bill, Tron. They're over that way, and me and Davey are way over here. But the greatest compliment we got was, man, you went on that little drum set, and you just killed it. I got to sing a couple songs. To where even the Kiss tribute band, except for the drummer, they came up and said, man, you see that little drum set that guy was playing? Man, it sounded like a freaking cannon going off. It sounded great, blah, blah, blah. Yep. And that you may want to do something with your drums and get that kick drum sound that he got. Because his sounded like wax paper every time he hit it.
And you had the Ludwig breakbeats?
I just had the breakbeats out. That's all I had.
Yeah.
And he had this big, you know, and he had the LED lights too.
Yeah.
You know? But it didn't sound good.
Yeah.
They were good at what they did.
Anyway.
I've seen some places that you played, like, you know, with Chris Marshall and stuff, or whatever back then. I've seen the small spaces that you've had to work with. And I've been like, how did he get in there? What did he do?
Did he
a crowbar and just say, let me rip out this wall. Let me move that over there.
Yeah, I had to disassemble my kit, even though it's small, but I'm in a corner. You know, oh, you've been there. You're in a corner. It's like, okay, let me just move my kick and snare and my ride, and I'll just jump through here. Then I'll put everything back together. And it's like, now, next time I'm coming out, it's break, you know.
Yeah.
We're done.
Yeah. For the longest time while I was sick, I even reset my drums up differently. I put a auxiliary hi-hat to the right of me.
Because
I couldn't do rides off to the side anymore. My body wouldn't let me. It just took a lot out of me.
Yeah.
So I went over to here, and it's just a little bit underneath where my ride, and it still is there today because I like it there.
I noticed that at your last gig, man.
Yeah.
I was like, that's cool.
Yeah,
I
have it over there.
I was
going to
get Thomas Lane.
No, just Paul Rogers type, Simon Kirk stuff, just going.
Yeah.
And it also helps me to sing, too, because I've got everything pretty tight now where I want it, and I can just sing. I have my microphone in front of me, just dropped right there in front, and I just
and
go
as a
for
singer,
it.
I'm sure you're, I don't know if it matters or not, if you're closed up like this playing. As your diaphragm, I mean, I'm not a singer, but you know, if it makes a difference,
being it does make a big difference. I have more room to work with it being over here
and breathe
more.
Yeah,
and I even did that to my electronic kit recently. My girlfriend and her brother helped me reset it up. I wanted my hi-hat over here, so we took all the cords off and rewired her, wrapped her back up, and now it's over here, right where I want it, you know. And I'm like, there we go. That's what I needed because I don't like doing this cross thing
so
anymore.
What you did was you got prepared before. So when you come to the gig, you knew what you wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
You weren't at the gig experimenting. That's something else, too, is you know, we've all heard the thing, you know, about the don't practice, you know, and all that stuff.
Uh-huh.
You know, so don't experiment at a gig, man.
No, like, I don't.
You have rehearsals and then you have practice.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, the way I see it, I practice this. I practiced that by myself.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a 9-piece band and they drive from North Carolina. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, not everybody, but we have people local too. Point being, we don't have time because we get to get together that much. You can't just come here to okay, well, what are we playing? To learn it. You know, you rehearse.
Mm-hmm.
If you mess up, then that's okay. Then you know what's happened. But, you know, it's not a jam session. We're not writing original songs.
No.
But that can bleed over into anything.
Band that I wasn't really into. So I make jokes to Kincaid like, hey, something's wrong with that speaker. You might want to fix that thing. What's wrong with it? Yeah. It's coming out of there. You know, this sounds horrible.
He doesn't pull the bow out.
What's he doing? I don't know. No, he does not. Don't give him any ideas.
Hey, Bill. Yeah.
Okay. No, Bill, don't. I kill you.
I remember that.
Yeah. But I, there's that one part in Kashmir, you know, da 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 da, you know,
yeah.
I still to this day screw it up because it just wasn't. I was born in 1971.
Me too.
I was born in the 70s, but that doesn't mean I know who the heck they were. You know, yeah. I was born when they were out there doing their thing or whatever, you know. Yeah. But John Bonham, definitely an amazing, one of the greats, of course, obviously. But when I was coming around, it was his kid, Jason.
Yeah.
You know,
got Jason Bonham's signed that drum head up there.
There you go.
Yeah, because I got to see him with Sammy Hagar.
Oh, see, there you go.
And I can't remember who. Michael Anthony was on bass over in Cherokee. That being said, I remember when he had his band Bonham.
Yeah. But
I was a big Zeppelin fan, you know, because Bonham intrigued me. But anyway.
The only guy I got to meet, you might have seen it recently, I got to meet the drummer for the Kentucky Headhunters.
Yeah,
I was just talking. And he signed my bottom hi-hat.
You know, dude, I was just talking with Chris Jones the other night. We did a podcast, and we were talking about him because Chris spent a lot of time in Nashville, and he was one of his influences.
He was one of mine, too, when they came out. I mean, I went and got the coon hat and everything.
He had the coolest chops.
And he still does.
Yeah.
And he is... Ultimately, which was great, because they were walking out and I was still on stage. I was like, I'll be right back. I got to go meet this guy, you know, and I ran out and said, excuse me, Fred. He's like, yeah, what's up, buddy? How can I help you? One of the nicest guys I had ever.
Fred Young, right?
Fred Young. One of the sweetest, nicest guys ever. Got a photo op with him. He came back into the restaurant for not only a photo op, but to also sign my bottom hats for me.
Yeah.
Because I asked him. He was very approachable. No, I like traveling with acoustic shows from Dayton, Crossville, Chattanooga, Spring City. I love going to Athens and stuff. Pigeon Forge, I love Gatlinburg. You know, I like going and traveling, make sure I'm out there playing and doing everything. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Knoxville is just so busy, 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 busy now, you know. Yeah. And so it's like, we'll go out of town, have a little fun, come back, did your thing. Good to go. But any chance, any time we ever get to play Knoxville, and we will be again soon, you know, we get a lot of our people from here that always come and support us and will come and see us.
Right.
Because they'll say, oh, you guys are always out of town. I'm like, yeah, I know. I'm sorry, but this is where we're going.
So not only are you guys a good band, I'm going to go on a limb and say attitude keeps everything together. Everybody has great attitudes.
They do.
And, you know, it's hard to find chemistry with ego, you know, without egos and the wrong kind of egos.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a certain ego you got to have, you know, but, you know, the over the top ego, man. Do you love it or leave it? Double kick pedal.
Leave it.
Okay. For what you do.
Yeah. I've attempted it. It's just
not even for accents. Yeah, it's not.
It's not my style. I just can't get both of them going to where how I want them to do it.
Yeah,
it would be something that I would like to learn before I, you know, it's like on a bucket list, if you want to call it, you know, the drummer's bucket list. Mm. But right now,
it's extra hardware to carry.
Just nah, I'm good.
Yeah, it's extra hardware to carry. How about a cowbell? The classic cowbell.
Yeah, I love my cowbell. I have a Travis Barker cowbell.
Oh, you're gonna love it.
I love it.
You're
gonna
love it on the cowbell?
I'm gonna love it on the cowbell. Heck yeah. All the time. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I love it.
And this one, man, drum solos.
I love it. It's just, it's all about placing them, you know, it's putting them in place. We'll do LaGrange ZZ Top, and I've put a spin on it. I'll do a little bit of a drum solo, and then I'll go into Wipeout to end it.
Oh.
So I've kind of mashed
so
both
it's,
of
so
those
you musically it. Place it correct.
I place it
it's
correctly.
It's not like the song's over. Okay, now introducing Scott, Naughty Scott Houston. Here's his drum solo.
No, we place it into a certain song.
In context.
In context.
So it works.
So in that frame or whatever you want to call it, I love it because in that context it works, makes me feel good. I got everything out of my system for the night, and I got to end with a classic drum solo like Wipeout. You know, so and the looks on people's faces when you're doing Wipeout, they're like, "Are you kidding me? This guy's doing Wipeout. Do we know anybody anymore that does that around here?" And if you do,
I never hear it.
Thumbs up 1,000 times, but
absolutely.
But if you don't.
Learn it.
Go for it. I think that's the thing where it's like every drummer's first song was Wipeout, or at least you learned when you were young.
I went through that. I thought I was playing it good, but I'm sure it sounded horrible. I appreciate you coming down and taking time out of your evening and your busy schedule to spend some time here and give some of your stories and insights and advice, man. I mean, you've lived it. You're still living it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I hope, you know, I know somebody will get something out of this, you know. So, man, I'm telling you, this is some really good stuff, man.
Definitely.
So I really, really appreciate you coming down and sharing your gift of music and drumming, bro.
I appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me, Scott. I appreciate it.
Let's do it again. Naughty Scott Houston.